friends
and strangers. Welcome to the lobby, GameSpot's weekly hangout, every Tuesday, 2 p.m. Pacific, right here on thegamespot.com. This week, Transistor is out next week, in fact, but a former GameSpot editor-in-chief and a current supergiant man, Greg Savin's in the house to show us that. He's also going to show us Thief from 1998, because why the hell not? It's Video Game History Month. We've also got Bound by Flames, Kevin Van Oort, cannot wait to play that. Plus, we're giving out a bunch of keys for Child of Light on a bunch of platforms as well. How are you, Kevin?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm feeling sorry that once again we've brought you in here to play a game you probably would prefer not to play.
It's fine. You actually like undersold the game a little bit. We were like, it's so bad it's not worth mentioning. It's not like a pile of poo on the ground.
Is that what a one gets on GameSpot? Because it's got a four. Is one pile of poo?
But on a scale of ten, it's not like it's just, you know, I don't know, whatever.
Or Band of Flame.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, don't worry, Bound by Flame.
Okay, yeah. Should I play this thing?
I think we should jump right on into it.
Yeah, let's jump in.
Give the people what they want.
What they want is Bound by Flame.
So Kevin. Can I do a quick rundown?
I just want to make sure.
Can you first address the alarming fact that you are on fire?
I'm going to do this. Now, this is a little... A little spoilery. So the game. So this is, I think, towards the end of the second chapter of the game.
Okay.
So
Bruce Willis is a ghost. Yeah. Don't believe it.
I'm at the stage where, see, over time you make these decisions. You have a demon living in you.
Oh,
and over time you make these decisions on whether to side with the demon's advice or kind of do your own thing.
Okay.
And if you do more demonic stuff, then you start turning into...
Yeah, guess which side Kevin chose.
Yeah, I totally chose with the demonic stuff.
His eyes are glowing red, there's horns coming out of his head, he's on fire.
So eventually you don't just have like one set of horns too. You get like multiple sets of horns the more evil you get.
I also read in your review that you can't wear helmets because you've got
You can't,
horns.
You can't.
That's kind of cool.
I'll show you.
That's
you absolutely cannot wear helmets.
I want to remind the folks
come
at home,
over here, and it's like
no.
Oh, it doesn't
helmet.
Say it doesn't say now because I basically scrapped my helmet, for items. But
While we're doing this, if anyone has any questions, same as ever, in the Twitch chat or in the comments, and they'll be sent on over to us.
Chris, the questions are all going to be, why do you suck? This game's better than that.
Okay,
but.
So it's not a question. Oh, I guess it is a question.
I'm not a big fan. Elaborate. That's one of my favorite things is when a cutscene transitions and everybody's in a different position than they were in because it's pre-rendered.
I love Mass Effect.
Wow. What is that lady's... What? With all those that lady.
So this is a concubine.
No. Good Lord.
Okay, yeah.
No.
So
that
Lord
one is?
Black
is
that yes. No, no she's Edwin. No. She's Edwin. She's just my magician
Why
friend.
Would she be
whose breasts are barely plan. Contained.
Yeah.
They're which like is, just resting on
which
shells.
Is the proper, for some people, that's the proper place for breasts to be is barely contained.
I feel like not. Mm-hmm. She didn't dress for the weather.
No. Also,
maybe she's cold.
You wouldn't prevent it. That's spiky. That's just a spiky.
This guy did. He's got a friggin' fur coat on.
This concubine has given us an opportunity. We must attack her while her troops.
So Edwin's kind of fun.
Yeah, it's a woman.
I'm gonna skip ahead a little bit.
How is the story and all the character stuff in this game?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
It's no Mass Effect or anything.
So mechanically, this is looking to me like it could go either way between Dark Souls or Viking Battle of Asgard.
They try to do Dark Souls-y, more Witcher maybe.
Okay.
But they don't quite get there for quite a few reasons. But so this is one of the choices that you get to make. I'm going to follow Edwin's advice and say, hey, I need the power of the tree, or
okay.
I'm going to try to save the men. And
this is kind of awkward. They've been staring at each other for a while now.
Well, Ed, she just accused him of spying on her while she bathes.
Yeah. He's totally a peep Tom. Tom Peep. What do they call that?
Peeping Tom.
Peeping Tom.
Peeping Tom.
I feel like just by being in this woman's presence, you are legally classified as a peeping Tom.
Ain't nowhere else to peep. Edwin, also a dude's name.
I'm skipping ahead a little bit more. Now, down comes the concubine.
All right.
She's got human legs and weirdo spider legs.
I sense a theme with the clothing here.
I'm not sure how her arms even work.
Is the theme exposed bosoms?
Yes.
Ding, ding, ding.
All the dude's bosoms seem to be pretty wrapped up.
Well, no, Kevin's on fire bosom is exposed, to be fair. Kevin, I was watching you fight this concubine earlier a little bit, and what I really like about this character model is like the human legs just dangling uselessly in front while she struts around on these arachnid things. They're grossing me out.
She does.
Oops. How is the combat?
I'm doing a terrible job of riposting.
Is she going to stand up against that wall the entire fight?
You rolled
off.
No, I can't dodge in this particular stance. There are three stances. One is warrior stance, which is what I'm in now. Mm-hmm. I would show you the others, but there we go. I did a proper block.
Oh, you got double kicked.
So that in these games, really the combat is kind of what makes or breaks it. What's the fundamental problem with combat?
Well, part of it is everything's an interrupt, a knockback, and it's one of my little pet peeves anyway. When everything's sort of an interrupt and a knock. Oops, I hit the wrong button.
Your gun's crafting
some
stuff.
Fun. No, not yet.
Your sword's on fire. Maybe you should hit her with it.
Tactics.
That's what I'm gonna do. First, I'm gonna heal up. I don't want to die on stream because that's never fun.
Those legs, you know what they remind me of? And you were actually just playing
baby.
This game earlier. Was actually the like Striders in Half-Life 2 Episode 1.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Those like tripod freaks.
Oh, I can also
place
traps.
Oh, do you mean the
traps.
Hunters?
Yeah.
The small ones?
Sorry, so I meant the smaller ones. The Striders hunters, are the huge ones. Right, of course, yeah. I meant the smaller synthetic ones.
Come on, walk
ones.
Over the trap. Come on. You're ignoring the trap. Come on. Over the trap. Over the trap.
Would you walk on the trap?
Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on, girl.
Please?
Come on, girl.
You ask nicely. Okay, there we go.
Concubine.
Yeah, there we go.
Come on, girl. Over the trap. Over the trap.
You seem to be spending a lot of time running around in circles to make your health bar go back up.
Well, that happens a little bit, but actually right now I'm just trying to get her to come over the trap.
You want to bait her onto your little firebomb?
Yeah, but she's not really doing what I want her to do.
That you've left there? Let's see.
Come on, over the traps. Come on, over the traps. I'm only doing this because I want people to see the traps.
Is it that good?
There we go.
No, they're not. Boom. It's just a tiny explosion.
That was it. Great. thank you.
Oh, she's going to do her thing.
That was cool. Damn, that was cooler than your trap, Kevin. She outclassed you there.
Yeah,
she did. It really is a thing.
You know what those weird legs remind me of? Is those inflatable costumes that people have that make them look like a centaur or something, where like the bottom half of their waist is dressed up as horse legs and they just have these human legs sticking out their front?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like it. Maybe we could dress up as concubines next Halloween. Like last year.
Probably be a little chilly. Yeah, right. Again?
Does it take this long to kill one enemy usually? Do you tend to
She's a boss, so.
Okay. How big are the mobs usually?
Small, it depends. Like, actually, taking on one thing really isn't that tough in this game. But sometimes when you have multiple things all at one time and they're all knocking you around and interrupting everything you do and
like,
it's hard to get a rhythm going.
So I just see Johnny Furcoat over here shooting arrows. What happened to Edwin of the Shelved Breasts?
She's off doing her
taking
own thing
a
for
TO's.
Now, she's all pissy.
Can you revive?
Or no.
Can you only have one companion?
Only
in combat
one at a
with
time,
you?
Typically. Yeah. Okay. There are a couple story points where
are they usually this useless? He's just standing in the background.
Yes, they're always useless.
Okay. He's taking some pot shots.
Except when it's like a spellcaster, sometimes they can like root them in place or keep them from casting spells, which is nice.
Exactly.
The problem is Edwin, who is one of the
baby
people that can do that. Edwin, the spellcaster who can do that, she's typically down in like 15 seconds.
Oh, wow.
Like she'll come in, if you have multiple enemies at one time, she's down. And you can't revive her through mechanics in the game. You can revive her by running away and tricking the game into so that you pull enemies and leave like the zone.
Yeah.
Like, and then she'll just stand up wherever she is and then they just start in again.
Right.
So there are ways to get around it, basically by running away from battle, but there's no actual revival.
Right. And nice guy 7667 is a nice guy and asks, if you had to pick one nice thing to say about this game, what would it be?
I actually really like the demonic stuff. Like, I like making the decisions. And then seeing how that plays out physically. It's sort of like if Fable, I mean the hard, like I don't know, if Fable and Dragon Age kind of had a baby in that
right.
sense.
Then the baby never really lived up to how good its parents were.
Baby had like a really satisfying and decent life, but never reached the
impressed anyone.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's kind of a stupid
which,
baby.
You know, would have been a totally happy life if not for the overachieving parents that just like overshadowed that baby's poor entire life. Pretty grim scenario.
Evan, what's this out on?
This is on Let me see. This is the PC version I'm playing here.
Sure is.
But this is also out on PlayStation 4 and I believe PlayStation 3, maybe?
Is this more like a regular dude?
No, this is actually the big... What you think of as the big meanie in this game. Oops. Oh, this is a good time to show you some crafting. So you can craft anywhere, which is kind of cool.
Being assaulted like by right the Frost Lord.
Right in the middle of the battle.
Yo, hold up. So, I gotta make this hammer.
TOs.
So you can go in and choose health potion, and right now I can only make two.
All right.
However,
tainted blood.
You can also go in there and see what else that you're missing. So I need tainted blood to make potions. Now I can go, oops, wrong button. So now I can come over here and I can make tainted blood from gold.
What?
So if I wanted to, I could make 53 tainted blood.
That is a lot of tainted blood.
That is a lot of tainted blood. And then I can go back in to health potion.
Is that like a commentary on capitalism?
And then I can make six more because I turned all my gold. Gold's like can be, alchemically changed into anything in this game.
Video games, man. You can just do whatever you want. Which is kind of interesting. It's fine.
The goal of all alchemy is to synthesize gold out of anything else. This is just the reverse of that.
It really is.
Kevin, thank you so much for being Bound by Flame.
Oh, are we done?
We are done with Bound by Flame. Amazingly, all the folks on the stream probably want to see some Transistor or maybe talk about Xbox
One stuff. Oh, man, but you're missing, like, big cutscene.
Well, if you want to know more about Bound by Flame, by all means, go to GameSpot.com and Kevin Van Orden's wonderful review of wonderful in a sense. Very well written review.
I think it's a good review.
It's a good review. I'm not saying
maybe,
a bad
maybe
job.
I'll stream some. People can follow me on Twitch or something.
There's even a video review.
There you go.
Yeah.
For looking at.
Yeah, totally.
We're going to talk about Xbox One stuff in just a moment. But first of all, we're giving away a bunch of keys for Child of Light. I believe we have it on a bunch of different platforms. Correct.
Sweet.
We have an Xbox One, PS4, and on the platform of choice, Uplay.
Heyo!
So PC for everyone. If you want to win that, follow at GameSpot on Twitter. Make sure you are following us and then send us a tweet with the hashtag GSTheLobby and your platform of choice so we know which one you want to win. We're giving them away during the show, so make sure you do it now and then we'll give them away at the end. I'm going to put that thing back in my ear right now. We're going to talk about Kinect or lack thereof in just a moment. But first of all, a game that's coming to Kinect. I bet the guys at Harmonix are real happy about this. Let's check out the trailer for Fantasia. That is a game that requires a little magic machine called Kinect, which is super popular. Microsoft came out with some news this morning, straight out of nowhere. Justin Haywald, GameSpot news editor, please explain to the folks at home what we know so far about this announcement.
So I wouldn't say that this was completely out of nowhere. This is something we've been conjecturing about for months now. That not only has the Xbox One gone through a $100 price cut, putting it at parity with the PlayStation 4, which it's needed to do for a while, but they've also gotten rid of the Kinect. We've said that the Kinect is the thing that's raising the price, that makes it $100 more expensive, and they've finally just gotten rid of it. It's surprising because they've said we're not going to get rid of it, and I thought maybe they'll do something else to get that price down. So it's a little surprising that they've reversed the focus on Kinect and to make that the thing that will make the price lower. But it's not surprising in that they needed to do something that would lower that price. And as we've seen, Kinect isn't terribly popular. There aren't a lot of games, you know, Fantasia, notwithstanding. There's a Kinect sports game. There's not a lot of other. There's not a lot of other games that use Kinect that make it an integral part of it. So if you're going to cut anything, I mean, that's one of the things that has to go.
So what is the price point now? What are we talking about?
Right now, it is a $399 machine. You can still get a Kinect. It is still a standalone thing. They haven't announced a price for that, but, you know, probably going to guess about $100.
Yeah.
Because that's how much they've reversed it.
Is the old bundle of $499 for Xbox One with Kinect still happening, or are they just replacing that SKU with the one?
I mean, this is good news because it's giving people choices. If you want the Kinect right now, you can still get the Xbox One that they offer right now with the Kinect bundled in, or you can get the $399 version with no Kinect.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a smart move. It's something that they've needed to do, but it's definitely not great for probably some developers who have put a lot of time and effort into these Kinect games. But do you guys play anything on Kinect?
That's the thing. I was pondering about this earlier on, and it's also maybe worth mentioning briefly as well that it's gone down to £350 in the UK, which is a substantially less price drop. It's only £50. So, like, I think in equivalent dollars, there's still like $100 difference between. It's outrageous. and also, I believe this isn't coming to Ireland yet because that's in the Eurozone. I was thinking about this morning. I have always wanted that one good Kinect game to come out. I feel like during the 360, I was thinking the same thing. I was like, one game that'll make it this thing worthwhile, and it'll all kick off. I was kind of happy when they brought the Xbox One version. They made it standardized because I thought it's going to be quite cool because now people are going to be encouraged to make good Kinect games.
Yes.
It's never happened.
How much time have they had to work with it? You know, what games are even out for Kinect now? You've got Kinect Sports Rivals, which there's like one or two decent games in there, but then the rest of it, I mean, most of the emphasis on Kinect at this point, I feel like, has been UI management.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the best thing for it.
Saying Xbox, do this thing. And even that is like 80% for me, and I have to use a stern voice that my wife hates, so I don't use it.
But also, that's fixing a problem with the UI that shouldn't really exist in the first place. It's only better to use it with the voice because that interface is actually kind of a mess.
Like the whole My Games and Apps thing, I don't know.
But it's really nice to be able to turn your Xbox on just by, like, speaking to it. Yep. Like, that is cool. Like, whenever I use something like that, it feels like the future. And then when it does work, like, that still also feels like the future.
That's
when you're
true.
Like, Xbox, Netflix, and it does exactly what you want it to. But like you said, it doesn't work quite enough. And the things that it adds to games are these small add-ons. You can't use a full-featured game. You can't have a game that's only movement, because that's tiring. Like when we play games, we want to sit down on the couch. You want to relax for a bit. So having a game that only uses Kinect is tiring.
Well,
it's something you're only going
to
do for
it. You need
bit.
To commit to a Dance Central, which are excellent Kinect games.
Yes.
You need to commit to a Gunstringer, which is actually like way less of a physical investment than Dance Central.
Because you can sit there.
Because you can do that thing, and that game was really good. But I guess my big question with this is why. In the middle of May, do they announce this?
So that's the other really interesting thing about this. This is an E3 level announcement. Like, this is a bombshell. This
right?
is the kind of thing that you just come out and like, $100 price drop. The fact that they're doing this in May is basically saying, we are so confident in what we have lined up for E3, we're going to make this all, like, seriously, we're making this about the games. We've already talked about TV and shows. We've pushed that out of the way. Mm-hmm. They've talked about the console and the price point, pushed that out of the way. And that's going to make E3 about the games.
It could also be a damage limitation thing, because no matter what they talked about at E3, even if they announced wonderful unannounced games that nobody knows about yet, the narrative was always going to be Kinect is gone, especially if they had announced it at E3, especially considering what happened last year. And maybe they don't want the second E3 in a row to be the story being that Microsoft have, you know,
the story of how they reversed this thing and went back on that thing and changed their plan that they had previously tried to hard sell us.
But it's nice that it is going to have a focus on the games. I mean, we're going to talk about PlayStation 4 and Xbox One games. We're not going to be discussing some kind of thing about the hardware or anything like that. Like, that's going to make E3 really about the games. And from Nintendo's point of view as well, like, we're probably going to hear something about their quality of life stuff because they've been talking about that for such a long time. But for them as well, it's going to be about the games. And that makes E3 itself, like, so much fun. It's like, this is the E3 that's all about games you haven't heard of before and, you know, sequels to games that we've been anticipating for such a long time.
Here's hoping.
I got some questions. I asked some folks on Twitter earlier today, what the people who owned Xbox Ones, what they felt about it. Craig Sutherland said, happy and sad. It's too bad
That this pretty much means that the Kinect is dead, but it could also help the Xbox One succeed in the long run. Do you think this is basically the death knell of Kinect, that when people are given the option that at retail they're going to opt for the cheaper one without the funny camera?
Well, yeah, I mean, they're going to go for the cheaper one. This puts the impetus on Microsoft to create experiences for the Kinect to make it have a long life. Yeah, I mean, really, the Kinect hasn't had much of a life beforehand. We've had Kinect with Xbox 360, and outside of, you know, the really cool music experiences like Dance Central, I never use it. Microsoft, the fitness game, Nike Plus, Nike Fitness Connect, yeah, or whatever. Like, that was also really good. And those are the only two games that I can think of that I loved having Kinect for. Gunstringer was cool, yeah, but...
We've got a big proponent of the UFC fighting fitness game, mm-hmm, as well, but I feel like the problem with Kinect now is the same problem I had before, right? It's a peripheral, so you need to justify that big extra expense. Why are people going to buy it? When it was bundled in with the Xbox One, people, like, I had it, and I was like, sure, I'll give voice commands a try. Mm. I'm not going to buy it for voice commands. I'm going to buy it if there's a game, if there's a compelling reason, you know. Maybe I would buy it for Skype, but then I have, like, a laptop with a camera in it, so, you know, I use it for Skype, but... those sort of add-on benefits, I think it's going to be tough for them to message how those little things are part of the Kinect value proposition, and it puts, they need something bigger. They're going to need to, like, bundle it with Fantasia or with something else in order to really help people get over that extra hump of spending that extra $100 now.
I wonder if that's something we might hear about at E3 then. And, in that case.
And, you know, speaking about Skype, we also learned that that's going to be part of everybody's experience on Xbox now. You don't have to pay for gold in order to access things like Skype, in order to access things like Netflix and those movie applications, which before were trapped behind that paywall, which made it just such a ridiculous proposition to pay extra for gold when this is something that you can get for free on everything, on your computer, on your PlayStation 4, on sometimes on your TV.
And it was actually the reason the iPlayer for BBC had such a hard time getting on as well, because they legally weren't allowed to charge for that service at all. There's some other information in relation to that stuff as well, tertiary stuff, like, for instance, the free games on the 360 is going to come to Xbox One in June.
Which we knew was going to happen, like, and just finally confirming this is going to happen. Like, no, seriously, guys, we're doing it. And for the anniversary of Games with Gold, you're going to have three games coming in June, which is kind of cool for people that have been investing in it for quite a while.
They haven't announced the game specifically, right?
I think, we had Dark Souls, Charlie Murdered, and one other game which is escaping my...
Okay, I saw Max the Cursed Brotherhood and Halo
Max
Spartan
the Cursed
Assault.
Brotherhood.
Yeah, maybe Halo Spartan
Halo.
Assault as well.
Yes.
Last point, and this is, I think, a very salient one I saw on Twitter earlier as well. TheWeave24 said, it's a bad idea by Microsoft. Kinect is the only thing that makes the console decent, different. What if Xbox drops the price further than the PS4? Has Microsoft basically made itself so homogenized by taking all the stuff that they went on about last year at E3, they've reversed essentially on all the fundamentally important ones? Have they just made it so that they've given people no reason now to choose between the two?
I wouldn't really say that's the case. Like, the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox just by themselves offer two very different UI experiences. Like, when one of the things that, you know, Xbox offers is the ability to switch between applications, like swiping, having two things running at the same time, which PlayStation doesn't quite do as well. And then some people prefer the Twitch experience on Xbox One over PlayStation 4. And the movie experiences, I found that Netflix is very different between PS4 and Xbox One. I actually just prefer using my TV because that's a lot quicker and easier. But I wouldn't say that they're that similar, especially when you compare it to the PC. I mean, the games architecture, the way that we experience games is really homogenized between everything. We get the very similar experiences. And this could really push Microsoft to try to get more exclusives. In the same way that Sony is known for games like Sony Santa Monica having Last of Us and God of War. Like, I think this will only push Microsoft to put even more into those exclusives to get games that you're not going to be able to get anyplace else. Because do you really need, like, a completely different way of interacting with that console? Like, why is that the thing that needs to set it apart? We want the things that set it apart to be the games. And, I mean, you can't forget that we also have the Xbox Live entertainment services. Like, they're going to be rolling out these news and... not news. They're going to be rolling out these...
The Halo TV show.
And they have a comedy program and some other just original programming.
I bet that comedy program won't be very funny. I'm putting money on it right now.
Louis C.K., Sarah Silverman were involved in it.
That sounds pretty good.
Your money's down already, Danny.
I was down as soon as they said, we have a comedy program. I was like, that's going to suck. And then Sarah Silverman came on and Louis C.K. was like, oh, that might not suck.
All right, we'll have to wait and see. Justin Haywell, thank you very much for coming on.
Thanks for letting me.
A whole bunch of mess about Kinect. We're going to be back. We still got loads more on the show. Greg Savin's going to be on with Transistor and Thief, oddly enough. We'll be back in a minute with new releases. First of all, to random questions with Peter Molyneux.
Powermonger, back in 1990. Why? Because it could have been brilliant, but it was just shit.
And we're back, and Greg Kay's getting mic'd up right now. There he is!
what was that question even about with Molyneux?
I don't know, I didn't hear it. I was too busy looking at Greg's awesome tan.
Thanks, I think I got it entirely on the way over here.
It's so hot outside.
It is very warm.
What's it like a week before launch?
It is strange.
Do you just sit out and it's done now, right? It's going through CERT and all that nonsense?
We just kind of stare at blank walls and just contemplate existence, awaiting the inevitable. Yeah, it's a weird time, because you've gone from like really kind of intense period of wrapping the thing up to... Yeah. Almost kind of there's still plenty of stuff to do to get ready, but in many respects, it's come to like a screeching halt of like, all right, it's done.
Calm now before the storm.
Yeah, start, you know, just prepare a few little bits and pieces, make sure the knives and forks and place settings are all fine.
And when just the OCD comes in.
Exactly.
What you could do is play some new video games.
Yes.
And Mary Kish seems to have the scoop on what's coming out this week. What is coming out this week?
Hey, Danny and Chris and Greg. It's good to see you guys.
Hey, Mary.
There's a lot coming out this week, but hopefully you guys don't have a PS4 because there's nothing for it.
Oh, really?
Wait, no. What? There's not a lot going on this week.
There a patch?
Maybe. That's about the best we could hope for. Maybe you just pull out an old classic, but mostly it's just basically Borderlands, Vita games, and... there's like retail games, so it's kind of a slow
week. This week?
It's maybe a good week to go outside or something. Let's roll it. I don't know. There's not too much going on.
All right.
We have Super Time Force.
Of course.
It's the biggest one. This is for Xbox One, 360. Vella was on here. Nathan Vella was on here not too long ago. This is a great game. It's totally worth it. You can even play a dinosaur that skateboards. You're going to see him in a second. Here he comes.
Ullosaurus.
It's only a matter of time before this happens. That's really important. Now, to retail, you can play Minecraft. This was already out. You could have already played it on PS3, but now your grandparents can gift it for you for Christmas and your birthday.
Wow, we're really stretching it this
week.
You
can buy a box with a Minecraft in it.
It's really, I assume it's retailed really nice. It's all set up in the box that you'd expect it to be.
You know, we've
in.
Been waiting for sales for this title to take off for so long. I think that this
I
is
have
just gonna...
big ambitions for this game. I really anticipate it to do well. Battle Block Theater is coming to PC and Linux. This is a sweet game. It's in 1 million P.
Or nice.
And I believe it's 100,000 frames per millisecond. So
intense.
If you're really into graphics, it's pretty heavy. It'll make you shit your pants, apparently.
Awesome. I can't wait. I hope this is going to be a PAX next time. It's
always now and forever, Danny. Now
and forever. Borderlands 2 is coming out on Vita. The frame rate looks just awful. I heard the autosave feature doesn't really work, so currently if you have it on PS3 and you want to play it on the Vita and continue your save, you can't. So
is Seb Ford and Cameron Robinson for sale this
They're
week
also
as well?
Available on retail,
okay.
And they're on sale.
Yeah.
So they're really trying to push those right now. And then just so you guys know, no video for Walking Dead because it's spoiler heavy.
Nice word.
But that does come out today and then throughout the week in different countries and then eventually on mobile. So
that is
available.
That's episode 3, right?
Yeah.
Cool.
That's the third one. So there's a lot, but not really. So that's it. That's all you got this
nice
week.
Nice one. Thank you,
Sorry,
Mary.
Guys. Go make a game because there's nothing else to talk about. See ya.
Easy peasy.
Appreciate it. We're going to go back and play an old game, because that's sometimes what you do when there's nothing new coming out. But first of all, an alternative thing you could actually do is watch live shows on videogames.com or twitch.tv/GameSpot. So let's just see if there are maybe some... Can we put together like a montage of all the different live shows we have?
We need a montage!
England, Cam. Thanks, Seb. Where have you been? Iceland, Seb. Was it Skyrim-like?
I'm Lisa Foyles. I'm so excited to be here on GameSpot and to welcome you to Analog. I'm here to fill your hole.
what is going on in our human brains that can make players of a game so passionate?
Oh, this video game is so gosh darn scary.
I can help you choose a Steam machine that's right for you.
I'm hungry for something new.
Titanfall, analog, new show on the site. Site was down yesterday, so you should probably go to GameSpot.com and look at that now, just in case. Lisa Foyle's latest on the crew.
Pretty cool new show.
Yeah, for sure.
Other games that are like the game that you like.
Exactly. The Gist, Skyrim mods on today, The Gist on tomorrow, Reality Check on Thursday, Cameron Robinson and The Point. I don't know what it's about. It was, you know what, actually, it was going to be about how much I love sports games and FIFA and how I'm playing it a lot because of the FA Cup, but then this Kinect news came out this morning, so I was like, throw that script away.
Gotta make it topical.
Yep, start again.
On point.
So, Mr. Kasavin, great to have you here.
Thank you.
Former, you are a GameSpot Hall of Famer. Hall of Famer, even? Hall of Famer.
Something like that.
Former EIC?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah, I guess so. So,
we brought you here to play your video game, but it is Video Game History Month. And we asked that you play a game from your past, a classic, as it were.
Yeah.
You gave me a list, and when I saw this on the list, I had to go for it. Thief the Dark Project from 1998. This is Thief Gold. This is the version that has some extra little bits and bobs on it.
Whichever you prefer. You can come up to like here.
Yeah,
if that's too high.
Let's try that. This will be good for the carpal tunnel.
Yeah. We can adjust a little bit.
So you haven't played this game, I'm guessing, in a while.
I have not played it in some time. I don't remember what the default.
Skip training.
Yeah, you got it. Oh man. All right. Try hard. Skip training. This game had really, I really loved. So my little trivia around this game, or one of the reasons it's personal to me, is it's the first 9+ score that I gave a PC game in my days of reviewing games on GameSpot. This game just blew me away when I played it. I didn't know what to expect going into it, but I was really blown away by how amazing the setting and the story of this game was, in addition to all of the just the really great and rich game systems here. It was like nothing I'd really played before.
What had Looking Glass made up until that point?
They had made, so they made, I th-
They did System
they
Shock,
did System
right?
Yeah, I was hesitating on that because Origin released it. System Shock was before. They did, I think they did Flight Unlimited 2. They did like a flight simulator also. But Thief was something, so WASD controls do
I think WASD work. I did it before we came on.
So I got my sword, I got my blackjack. If you're a Thief player, you know that you should not, oh man, if only I knew how to put away my blackjack. It's all good. So there's a great, the protagonist of this game is a great character named Garrett. And early on you find like patrolling guards here and he's like, how's it going? And you just have that, your first amazing moment of like, man, I'm a thief. Like no one knows what I'm all about.
That dude is not alarmed by you lurking in the shadows.
And you can just go, and totally whiff. That is Thief in a nutshell. So you clock dudes out. This game wasn't much of a, let's see, how do you?
Right click, I think it was to pick people up.
Now I am carrying homeboy around. He is out cold and I could just, you know, leave him out of sight somewhere. There's that little gem at the bottom of the screen. I don't know why Stealth Games did not steal this because it was so good. It worked so well. That little red light.
Shines light brighter.
Yeah, it's just telling you how concealed you are or not. And it worked really well. Basically when you're just walking around, people treat you like a civilian, but as soon as you break into one of the places that you're trying to pilfer, then, you know, guards are on patrol, and the game was tuned in a really interesting way where, you know, you're a thief, not a fighter, so in head-on fights, you tended to lose.
Yeah, if you got more than one person, you were kind of hold.
So I think I think he's gonna be all right with me, because I'm just minding my own business.
He's not gonna call you a tapper.
Yeah. He didn't do anything to me, but for the viewers at home.
This came out in 98. I had to look up the exact date. It was the end of November. I think it was actually 2 weeks after Half-Life had come out.
Yeah, I mean, 1998, it was a really insane year for games. Half-Life came out.
Metal Gear Solid?
Metal Gear Solid, StarCraft came out, Ocarina came out, like everything came out. Jeez. I think like Baldur's Gate and stuff. So basically like the, like a classic game in every modern genre, I think all came out that year. So Thief was, I think, overshadowed oh god, that's terrible, to some extent by stuff like Half-Life, but its legacy for sure lives on. I feel like there's a whole generation of game designers for whom this game is very sacred.
And out of this studio came like a whole generation of designers who then went on to, you know, Ken Levine onto Irrational, and then folks who made Dishonored, like, yeah, they came out of this studio as well.
I remember where to go. You have to go into that room where that dude is, and there's like a well. So, like, you have to knock him out, or...
Drunk, I see. Yeah, he is probably just having a good time. We could leave him, but again, it's this kind of... Oh, he's got a key. So we could just steal the key, but...
Yeah, he's... Kneecap him?
There we go. Nice. But, you know, yeah, so he'll feel that one in the morning.
You are like a real lean guy. Yeah, yeah. Whenever you pull that arm up, I'm like...
Yeah, this game was, you know, man, it's not a muscular open fella. Doors?
I think you equip the key on the...
Yeah, and there's some interface stuff, you know, that's one of the hardest things about...
I always remember loving the key icon.
Feels about 15 years old.
Yeah.
Do it again. Is it mouse wheel or...
Shoot it with arrows.
Shoot it with a water arrow. You can go into the menu. I got some questions here. The folks are asking questions at home. What do you plan for the near future once Transistor is released?
Nothing.
Bathing, sleeping on top of a pile of money surrounded by hundreds of beautiful women, obviously, when it's massive success.
That we shall see. In all seriousness, we don't plan that far. One of the nice things about being small is, let's check the menus here. We don't have to plan too far ahead, and for us, it's like any plans that we attempt to have right now, I think would feel sort of false, because we use item mouse too. Relook, drop item.
Next
man,
item
PC games.
Is empty? Yeah, look how... I love when I went into the control bindings, there were defaults for Quake controls.
Let's just...
Yeah.
Beautiful. All right.
Why in you? Oh, you got it there.
There it is. Oh, yes.
All right.
So that was like the toughest part of the game so far.
This looks like a loading screen to me.
Yep.
Woo!
Yeah!
Anyhow. Oh, no loading screen. Right. How about that?
But you are inside of some sort of green soda
yes.
pop.
Yes.
So
the green
be
soda
careful.
Pop is an important part of the story, so pay close attention.
What did you think of the sequels? Deadly Shadows was kind of like a different.
I reviewed Deadly Shadows for GameSpot, as a matter of fact. I quite enjoyed Deadly Shadows more than most people, seemingly. Deadly Shadows had a really remarkable, highly memorable level called, what was it, Shellbridge Cradle that was designed by Jordan Thomas, who became the creative director of Bioshock 2 and stuff like that. So that I remember rather vividly in Thief 3. Thief 2 was cool, but it had that sense of, like, to some extent
inside
it was more of the same for me, so it didn't have as much of, like, the magic of this game of, like, everything is new. This whole world is new, and that was just a really amazing feeling. So, yeah, just like infiltrating these environments and like finding the characters in them, this sense of, you felt really deviant like breaking into these places. And then, yeah, so here are the water arrows. This is like a classic part of Thief, and you have these torches, and you shoot a water arrow, and you put them out, and guards, you know, their AI and stuff reacts to it. So there's a dude. So this is like a good early example where if he just sees me, he'll go to town on me, but I can make that more difficult for him. Stay hidden.
We've got about a minute or two left of this, so feel free to just
murder him
if
yes.
you want.
You're speaking
you
my
want.
Language now. I want.
At last.
Let's see.
I played this about a year ago on Random Encounter and was surprised by how tense it still was.
Yeah.
Because I always remembered when you got caught in this, it felt like game over.
Nicely done.
Yep.
Right to the spine. And one to grow.
So
up.
Yeah, the game, I mean, I'm getting into this game just playing it again now. It's really a fantastic game. You can play it in all kinds of crazy ways. You can play it in a really expressive way, you know, not killing anyone or killing everyone as the case may be, and all sorts of stuff. So yeah, Thief. genre classic for sure.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for playing some Thief. We're going to have a go at a much more recent game that you have a much more of a closer affinity to.
Yes.
But first of all, we've got a trailer coming up. Well, actually, what I want to say first of all is Thief Gold is available on GOG.com for $10. It's actually on Steam for $7 at the moment, so it's a little bit cheaper on there. It's got the whole full game of Thief and then a bunch of extra missions that they released after the fact as well. Speaking of which, I believe there's a new Titanfall trailer. I think stuff releasing after the fact.
New maps!
Tentative segue. Titanfall, do it.
Swampland. Tall, massive trees throughout the swamp provide new movement opportunities for agile, resourceful pilots, as well as intermittent cover in Titan-to-Titan combat. Combat takes place at multiple elevations between the upper passages, the main deck, and the low-lying drainage canals, sometimes across long sidelines, requiring pilots to develop a strong understanding of this industrial battleground. Games, characterized by long, transparent wall-running paths and a confined central corridor, this simulation places a premium on each pilot's ability to discover new ways to use these strategic routes against their foes.
Trailer took a little bit of a long time to
end. Are you expecting some message to scroll up at the end? Like pricing information, release date? Nope.
Xbox One. Titanfall Expedition is the first DLC pack for all y'all who've got season passes for that game. But speaking of games that are coming out much sooner than the rest of the...
Nailed
it! The segues aren't working today. They're just... It's not happening. I'm sitting here on my shorts. I got my hair, looks awful.
You got your shin and elbow wounds hanging out here.
Yeah, I got my wounds. I fell over on Sunday night. Yeah.
Whenever someone says fall over, I just picture them just like teetering over to the side like a tree.
I was like an old lady falling down the stairs. I had no control
like
over it.
Like horrifying and grim.
My knee there cut a bit. And it was so late and I had one or two drinks. So when I got home to like patch this up, because I didn't have any bandages because I've only moved here like 5 months ago and I don't have bandages yet.
I'm going to guess old t-shirt. What do you think?
You think old t-shirt?
I actually know the answer to this.
Oh, you know
the answer? Right.
Unfair advantage.
I duct tape a sock to my arm, and I forgot, and then I woke up the next
morning.
Was
it a clean sock?
No, yes. I woke up the next morning. It was the sock I...
You took it off your foot and put it on your elbow.
I want to use a clean sock.
Improvisation.
And then, that's right. It's what you had in your inventory at the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, what are you going to do?
Yeah, it's like bandages. That's it. I was playing Sir, You Were Being Hunted, and used bandages. Rags for bandages, so it's the same thing. The worst part was we've a dude staying with us in our house who's like a friend of one of my roommates, and he walks out, and I walk out with just this bloody sock duct taped on my arm. I'm like, I don't usually look this much of a piece of crap.
Hey, anyway, this is a safe place for you to stay.
Anyway, enough about my horrible existence. Greg Kasavin is here with Transistor, the second game from Supergiant Games.
That's right.
You guys, of course, released Bastion a number of years ago now. And you've been working on this one for about 2 years, and it's out next week.
That's right.
All right,
let's
hop straight into
it. Yeah, this is the very beginning of the game. This is essentially what we, and I will just rudely talk over.
Go for it.
The voiceover that you're hearing here, but yeah, we like to throw you in at the deep end of it in our games and just get you playing as quickly as possible. And then, because you got the whole game to figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's going on is you play as this character called Red, who discovers this unusual weapon called the transistor, and no sooner does she find it than these kind of bizarre forces appear and are desperate to recover the weapon by any means, basically take her out. Why that is happening, who wants her dead, what the significance of the transistor is, that's all a big part of the story that you'll discover.
And who wants her dead thing is actually kind of hints at this like vaguely noir vibe you guys have going here, which I've really appreciated in the time I've got to sort of check the game out. And it's kind of got, I feel like the like big impersonal city, it's a big shift from where you guys were in Bastion, but how's it been to like play around with that new setting, with that new tone?
Yeah, it's been a really, like for me, and I think for pretty much all of us on the team, I think it's just been a really exciting part of this. I mean, after we finished Bastion, we really liked just making up our own world and setting and seeing that people actually enjoyed what we came up with. Mm-hmm. So having made this weird fantasy frontier game with Bastion, we wanted to see if we could come up with something again that, you know, just had our own take on it and had its own feel. So we wanted to, having done fantasy, we wanted to see what we'd come up with more in the science fiction direction. And we started with kind of the cyberpunk aesthetic, the kind of cityscape. We didn't want like laser guns and spaceships and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But then we kind of systematically rejected pretty much all of the conventions of cyberpunk. There's no like big fat magnums and, you know, flowing trench coats and brain implants and those kind of things. We love all that stuff, but it's been done so well by so many of the things that inspire us that like we wanted to just come up with our own angle on it. So in short, we ended up with this.
From the brief time I've played with it, I love all the storytelling in this first chapter, at least what I've played before, is really remarkable in terms of just like all the inconsequential sort of stuff, like being able to look through that. And the way in which, I don't know, I associate a lot of these types of games with farming or just repetitive mode.
Right.
But the pacing of this, has that been a really important part?
It really is. We are like big on sort of non-fat game design, as it were, of like we want it, we really value efficiency of storytelling and basically just respecting the player's time. There's like a lot of, we want to make these kind of meaty games with really rich systems that you could sink your teeth into, but at the same time make the sort of thing where you value the time you spend with it. You feel like your time is being respected, like I said. So that means having a particular pace to it and having like sort of a frequency of interesting things happening per unit of time. Being able to take in the world of the game through all sorts of different sources. You have these kind of informational terminals here that are revealing, I think, little aspects of how this world works as you go on through.
And next time you get that Wii survey feature they had, Ask Me or
inspired something. By the Ask Me service.
Can you just explain some of the combat mechanics that are happening here for folks who don't know?
Yeah, this is really at the heart of the game. The transistor is this kind of all-powerful weapon, and one of the things it can do is stop the world and let you plan your next set of actions and then kind of execute them in a supercharged fashion. So we wanted to combine kind of the pleasures of classic turn-based games and tactical RPGs with the immediacy of action RPGs. So you could play this game like an action RPG, press the buttons and hit stuff, and we want it to be really easy to pick up and play. But then we very early on introduced this kind of strategic planning mode where it really kind of makes you stop and consider your actions and really become, I think, invested in how you play. And we really wanted to get the kind of suspense out of it that we feel that a lot of classic games like that have, where you have that moment before you hit go on your turn where you're like kind of biting your nails in anticipation, wondering whether it's going to go spectacularly wrong or go just as you planned. We wanted to have that happen as part of the moment-to-moment play. So it's a really powerful ability, but you discover early on that it does have certain limitations. Like this particular enemy, you find that she will change position every time you hit her. So even though on some guys you could just kind of go to town on them, She is resistant to that, so you're going to have to find another way of dealing with her. And we want players to just be mindful of how they're fighting and use cover and use position and all that kind of stuff. Just be thinking about a lot of interesting things as they play.
And amazing how, like, this eerie character design and the sort of ominous floating and attacks can make the innocuous words young lady, you stick them together and all of a sudden it's really sinister.
Yeah, no, thank you. Yeah, we try to, again, from my point of view, it's all kind of part of the exposition is almost a bad word when it comes, people have a negative connotation with what that word means, but for me it's really like everything is exposition, so you're just learning about the world in every respect, even from the names of these things that you're fighting and every aspect of the interface and so on. So we try to use all of those different tools to give you a sense of what the world of this game is like.
I can hear somebody speaking there, obviously we're talking over it. Pitted the Great on Twitch asks, is there a cool narrator again? One of the most wonderful things about Bastion, unique aspects, was the narration throughout it. Have you guys done anything?
You can say that. It is not, it is, so every member of the team that worked on Bastion, including Logan Cunningham, who is the voice of the narrator, worked together again on Transistor. That was very much our goal, is just to stick together and make something new.
Excellent.
We don't have, in fact, the sword, the Transistor itself that Red is carrying around is speaking to her, and Logan Cunningham is voicing that character. It's not a narrator per se, it's not like an omniscient character with some foreknowledge of the events. He's in the world of the game, kind of experiencing the events of the story as they occur. So from my point of view as the writer, it's a very different kind of narrative mode required kind of a very different writing style. We think the character itself rather different as well, but it was really wonderful to work with Logan. I think the world of Logan as an actor and just as a dude. So it was just great to get to work together again on a project.
Monkey Robot on GameSpot asked a question that I think is very interesting, especially considering your previous life as a games critic. What are the games slash experiences that have influenced what Transistor has become?
Oh man, this is like
I
this.
I opened up Pandora's box.
No, this is the hardest for me because in my mind it's all like it's such there are so many things. Like we were just playing Thief. Thief is an inspiration to me. I don't think you'll see any real evidence of Thief in this game, but like I was talking about how amazing like the world building is in Thief, and that to me is like a huge inspiration from a world building standpoint, for example. But then, you know, it's a lot of it's so many things because there are many games from a particular era, though. I think that like mid to late 90s era is really inspiring to us as a team. A lot of our favorite games come from that era, such as Thief or another game I mentioned earlier, Baldur's Gate. So that in that game, you could pause and issue orders. That wasn't really like a central part of the game, but that was the type of thing we were thinking about of like, hey, what if that could be extended to become, you know, less of like kind of an interface assist and more of like a central component of the play experience.
Do you feel like you could have gone on to games development if you hadn't been a critic before? Do you feel like that was an essential part of learning about what games are?
Well, so for me it was for sure because I wanted to make games since I was a little kid, since I was like 8 years old. But I did not take to teaching myself to program particularly well.
This bit's pretty great.
Yeah, really, this like, is...
doesn't he say something to you?
Yeah. This is our little Looney Tunes kind of moment of, these guys chase you out of the room and you discover that these enemies you're fighting, they level up just as you do. So
sorry, but you were saying...
Oh, just... you know, for sure, like... Learning to think critically about games has been essential to whatever it is I've been able to do as a game developer. It's given me confidence in my convictions about just having a particular perspective on things, and that it can be really hard to make decisions when working on games because you could design things in any number of ways, and just like having a sense of how you want something to feel and having a knowing which things you think work well, which don't. I mean, I really value my past experience at just having been able to just play a lot of games and think about what worked about them, what didn't, not just, you know, going past the superficial of like, I thought that was awesome. Well, why?
Yeah.
What worked for you about that? Or what didn't work for you? What didn't you like? And sometimes you get these really interesting cases of, it's a game, you know, you didn't like it, but it had some really amazing idea in there that you thought maybe with a little more, with a little something else, maybe that idea could have been amazing. That kind of stuff I always valued as well.
There's a lot of people in both Twitch and GameSpot asking this question. I'm going to throw it to NiceGuy7767. The soundtrack is amazing. Who did it?
That is the work of Mr. Darren Korb. And with our vocalist Ashley Barrett, it's they again they're the Darren did the soundtrack for Bastion.
That's our way out.
Bastion's the first game Darren's ever worked on, okay. You know, I think he's
five blocks
well
down.
People will see for right. themselves mm. How the music is once again a very big part of this game, and I think there's some really fantastic stuff on here. Darren is really remarkable at what he does, and again, an awesome dude. So it's really my pleasure to get to work with a guy like that, and we're really excited for the soundtrack for this game, how people are going to take it. Cause,
are you going to release it separately?
We have a standalone soundtrack release that'll be there on Tuesday, same as the game.
Do a vinyl version.
Some people have suggested that
sure
perhaps
have.
We should. It's something that we. The thought has crossed our mind, but like I said, we have no plans beyond the launch, so we shall see. So we're about to get into crazy Uncharted territory here.
Okay.
We have never shown a minute past the end of this sequence.
I
didn't
fantastic.
Plan this far ahead.
I've seen this motorbike sequence so many
times.
Yeah,
yeah. Normally it ends here at PAX, but I'm not going to play too much farther. It's really important to us to not give away too much, but I will show you that there is, in fact...
Stop whenever you feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Every little bit.
Sneak peek.
We'll take it. Yeah.
Obviously, this is an earlier build as well. This isn't the retail or
version. Oh no! This is this is pretty much it.
Oh man! All right.
So you arrive.
You can
so
just
Red,
leave this here. It's fine.
Red has decided to. The transistor suggested that maybe Red should get the hell out of town, and it seems Red has other ideas. So she's going.
Okay.
She's going somewhere. She's on a mission.
All right, a sneak peek. You'll have to wait another 7 days to see any more for yourself. What platforms is this out on? How much is it going to cost?
PlayStation 4 and PC via Steam. Coming, Tuesday next week for $20.
Awesome. So. What are you going to do then on launch day? What does that involve?
Well, first thing I'm going to do is just panic.
Okay.
I'm just going to be looking at reactions to the game.
Yeah.
I am very, very interested to see what people think of it. So I think that is mostly what I'm going to be doing, just trying to absorb all the impressions out there.
Were you ever a don't read the comments guy when it came to reviews or anything, any content you did here at GameSpot?
I don't like comments on reviews. I don't mind them as much as many people on other things.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are actually some really funny. I think comments have almost a bad reputation sometimes. That there's some really amazingly funny stuff that happens in comments spontaneously on occasion, and then there's the other stuff. But yes,
you get a good filter going. And then
No, but there are certain message boards and things that shall not be named necessarily that I happen to keep a close watch on.
Yeah,
folks there, it's like they're unfiltered. They're just saying what they think.
Yes,
even if. You know, their minds are filled with horrible, hateful things. There are sometimes kernels of truth in some of those things, and I like to see what the impressions are one way or another, because those are the people who, you know, ultimately these are people who have like taken the time to say something about this game, if not to buy it, and so on. And we respect that, we value that. That's the reason we're still around.
And then similarly, on the other side, will you be reading reviews?
Oh yeah, will
is that
I?
Weird for you?
No, it's okay. I used to get asked like when I first went into development, like some of the guys I worked with were like, "Is it?" They asked the same question.
Yeah.
I'm like, I think I'm the best equipped to handle this than most of you. Like for me, it's like developers know what they're putting out there. I think ultimately,
right? Yeah, like in their heart of hearts.
Yeah, and our philosophy is like you can't argue with someone's experience with the game. If they like it or if they don't like it, like you can't. You can't go, no, man, you weren't playing it right. You didn't play it on the right difficulty or whatever. That's the game's fault that it didn't, you know, live up to whatever that player was expecting. The game fell short for that person, and you gotta just take it and find whatever truth is in there and see if you care about that for your next go around. So we value all that stuff, and yeah, we're kind of waiting on pins and needles to. At the same time, you know, we have no, from a certain point of view, we for sure don't know what people are going to say exactly, because like I said, you know, we've only ever shown a tiny portion of this game. We got a whole big game behind those first 20 minutes or so. So yeah, we shall see.
You haven't got much longer to wait. Greg Sabin, thank you so much for coming
pleasure.
On.
Thank you.
And hanging out with us and playing Thief as well. Much appreciated. We got one little more bit of housekeeping to do. It's my favorite part of the show, where we're giving away a bunch of codes for Child of Light. Speaking of small indie games that are out on consoles that are rad. We've got a bunch of winners here. I don't know what you won it on, but you should know because you tweeted us. XXNSK Reaper XX. Evolutionary underscore 69, very good. Game Taffy Ben, Pandemonium 86, he's 28 like me. Darnell 0216, who presumably was born on February 16th and lives in Europe. Crimson Jester and X Saint Jimmy 25. Check your DMs, you should all be getting a bunch of codes for a Child of Light.
GameSpot's Game of the Month for April.
That is very true. Awesome. Who knows? You might be GameSpot's Game of the Month. Not you personally. Your video game might be GameSpot's Game of the Month.
That'd be nice.
We'll see. Thank you very much again for coming on. We'll be back next week, everyone. Thank you so much for hanging out in the lobby. Greg Miller is going to be on. We're going to play some Ghostbusters. And I believe Wolfenstein is out that week as well.
Yeah. Next week?
Yeah. We'll see what happens.
Yeah.
All right. Adios. Thanks for hanging out, everyone. And see you next time in the lobby. 2 p.m. Pacific.